Beer has been brewed for thousands of years. A mixture of malt, hops and water ferments in this open tank. The fermentation is caused by yeast cells, turning it into beer. Mmm, cheers. Let's have a look under the microscope. We can see it's only 5 to 8 micrometers long that convert the sugarish extract into beer. Similar yeasts make wine and bread and many other products for us. Laboratory strains, such as the ones we are now seeing, play a central role in today's biological research. When placed on an appropriate growth medium, yeast cells divide by budding. A protuberance appears on the surface of the cell and grows into the spherical bud. The bud neck is pinched off. Both the old and the new cells continue budding. In real life, the cell cycle is not a matter of seconds, it takes about 2 hours. A bud starts its separate life in stage G1. Each cell has a nucleus invisible without special stains. DNA synthesis begins at the time of bud initiation or a little before it. The S period of DNA synthesis extends over 1/3 to 1/2 of the cell cycle. The nucleus stretches out through the neck into the bud, then divides into 2 equal nuclei, one on each side of the neck. The cell cycle is completed with the formation of a wall between mother and daughter cells. The mother and daughter cells and all their descendants are genetically identical and constitute a clone. The yeast cell wall is largely made of glucan and mannan. The scar tissue formed on the mother cell after budding contains another polymer, chitin. The scar tissue is unable to bud again. Each new bud appears on a different spot of the mother's cell surface. After the mother cell has produced a score of daughters, it cannot bud anymore and dies. Yeast is thus among the simplest organisms whose cells cannot divide indefinitely but have a limited lifespan. On solid food surfaces, the progeny cells accumulate on top of each other, and in a couple of days, they form colonies visible to the naked eye. A single cell may thus form a colony containing many millions of cells, which, except for rare mutations occurring during growth, are all genetically identical. The cells in nature and in laboratories, however, form a varied lot. Many variants are available with different metabolic characteristics. For example, a single small change in the genetic information has made these cells accumulate a red pigment and require adenine for growth. Besides vegetative reproduction, yeast can go through a sexual process. These 2 yeast cells are genetically different. Scientists usually work with haploid yeast strains. There are 2 mating types or sexes of haploid cells, called A and alpha. Separated from each other, they can be maintained indefinitely in culture. When 2 haploid cells of opposite mating type grow together, they exchange chemical signals which stop their budding, render them sticky, and change their form. The two haploid cells then fuse to form a single diploid cell, the zygote. Here is a mixture of haploid cells of opposite sex. They have formed clumps under the influence of sex-specific chemicals called pheromones, which are small peptides. Pairs of haploid cells of opposite sex fuse to form diploid zygotes, with a very peculiar dumbbell look. Many haploid cells do not fuse. Yeasts have no active way to look for partners. Now let's watch the conjugation of these three cell pairs. The pheromones stop the cell cycle at stage G1 and inhibit budding. Budding resumes some 2 hours after mating. The result is a mixture of diploid and haploid cells. The haploid cells tend to be smaller and rounder than the diploid cells. Just before mating, the conjugating cells change their form from globose to pear-like under the influence of the pheromones. The fusion of the cells is immediately followed by the fusion of their nuclei to form a diploid nucleus. The first bud usually appears in the middle of the zygote, which then looks like a clover leaf. The zygote and its daughter continue to bud. A clone of identical diploid cells is formed. The cell cycle of the diploids is very similar to that of the haploids. Diploids may thus be kept indefinitely in culture. This diploid is on a starvation diet. Then it undergoes meiosis and forms 4 spores. They are haploid. The genes of the diploid are distributed to the 4 spores. For each character, 2 of the 4 spores will resemble each of the haploid ancestors of the diploid. Thus, 2 of the spores are A and 2 alpha. These diploid cells have been fed an acetate and starved for nitrogen. They look a little different, have accumulated lipid droplets, and have stopped budding. They made a round of DNA synthesis and entered meiosis. In meiotic prophase, active genetic recombination takes place. The diploid cell converts to an ascus containing 4 haploid cells called ascospores. More asci are now being formed. Some cells do not sporulate and remain diploid. With sporulation, each of the 4 nuclei produced by meiosis ends up in a separate ascospore, and the 4 ascospores in an ascus. The cell walls of the ascus and the ascospores are chemically different. It is thus possible to dissolve the ascus cell wall without damaging the ascospores. The ascospores may then be separated from each other. When the ascospores are taken apart and allowed to grow separately, each forms a haploid clone. The ascus thus gives rise to 4 clones. With the help of a micromanipulator, the ascospores are distributed at will on a solid medium and allowed to form separate colonies. Tetrad analysis is the genetic study of the four clones produced by each ascus. It is a powerful tool of yeast genetics, which finds no equivalent in higher plants and animals. The 2-2 distribution is characteristic of nuclear genes in heterozygous diploids. Here's the germination of an undisrupted ascus whose wall is breaking up. Contiguous cells of opposite sex fuse to form new diploid zygotes. The result is a complex mixture of diploid and haploid cells of different genetic constitutions. In this other case, the two pairs of brothers and sisters immediately react to each other and form two diploid zygotes. The resulting population will all be diploid but not necessarily genetically uniform. So far, we have been looking at heterothallic yeasts, the most usual in laboratories. But not all Saccharomyces strains are heterothallic. In fact, most of the wine yeasts and other natural strains are homothallic. Haploid homothallic strains easily change sex. Cells that have divided may change their sex in the second generation. Mother and daughter, oh no, daughter and father, may fuse to form a diploid zygote. Sex switching is characteristic of homothallism. Here are four separate homothallic ascospores. Mother and daughter do not react to each other. It is only in the second generation that sex switching leads to cell fusion. Here are two other homothallic ascospores. First budding, second budding, cell fusion, best upper left. The diploids continue to grow. If the homothallic ascospores germinate in the ascus, a brother and a sister can fuse immediately without sex switching and form a zygote. The progeny of the other ascospore, after two budding cycles, changes sex and forms another diploid. No sex switching is observed in this homothallic ascus because the two pairs of ascospores immediately form two zygotes. This double conjugation was also seen in the previous intact heterothallic ascus. The resulting population are wholly diploid but may not be genetically uniform. The life of homothallic yeasts is similar to that of higher animals and plants in that they spend most of their time in the diploid stage, with only brief excursions into the haploid stage to increase genetic variability. The heterothallic yeasts have the additional possibility of remaining indefinitely haploid. This facilitates many forms of genetic manipulation, and that is why heterothallic yeasts are preferred by scientists.